Thank you all for joining this webinar. This webinar is brought to you by Terralogic and Datto together. My name is Venkatesh Jayakumar. I am VP for IT services at Terralogic, a technology solution provider. So we have been in the business for almost 9 years, started back in 2008 as pure software testing and development services company. And as we grew, we started to add new services portfolio. So the first one was Mafic Technology, which we acquired as an IT services company back in 2011. And then we also added IT strategy and consulting. Back in 2015, we merged with another company called InfoNam in Vietnam, and now we are called as Terralogic. So before it was Paxstar Software Solutions. Now, given our growth in last 9 years, now if you look at, we have close to 1,000 employees with a global presence at 4 locations. With the 76 plus customer engagements and across the domain. So we are not like very specific to constructions or industries or any specific thing, but we are across multiple domains. And I would just want to give a quick brief of what we do on the IT services. If you look at, this is a glimpse of the overall IT services that we provide, from managed services, from SOC operations to design services, network operations and cloud. And basically we partnered with Datto a few years back to provide backup and recovery solutions to our prestigious clients, and we have been, and they have been great in terms of their product, their support, and we love Datto products. And this is one of the reasons when we wanted to decide to create kind of an awareness, because last year we found that a couple of our customers were about to get affected with WannaCry and a couple of ransomwares, but because of our already implemented Datto solutions, they were safe. And we thought that this message should go to all who is going to be part of the new 2018 trends and the technologies, and ransomware is going to be a number one threat to all the IT companies. And that's why we decided to have this webinar sessions. So thank you again for joining this webinar. Now I request Michael to provide us an insight of how to protect the data from ransomware. Over to you, Michael.
All right. Perfect. Thank you very much. So my name is Mike DePalma. I'm one of the channel development managers here at Datto. For those of you not familiar with Datto, just a quick 30-second overview. We are a backup and disaster recovery company based out of Norwalk, Connecticut. Celebrated our 10-year anniversary last year. Pretty cool story. Our CEO, Austin McCord, he is only 32 years old. Founded the company when he was 22. Started building these devices by hand out of his parents' basement, actually. Fast forward to 2015, and the Wall Street Journal did give us a $1 billion valuation. So at that time, we were the only unicorn company in the state of Connecticut. Growing globally, we now have 26 offices around the world, over 900 employees. And we do protect over 390 petabytes of data worldwide. It's one of the largest private clouds in all the world. So we've got 9 data centers throughout the world, 2 here in America, 1 out in Salt Lake City, Utah, and 1 in Reading, Pennsylvania. I'm going to get to the importance of those 2 locations and how that ties into cybersecurity and the redundancy of information. But the idea here is you've got multiple copies of your data in completely different geographical locations, and it's going to stay in America. We don't store the data anywhere else for the American customers. So the idea here today is kind of rethink backup in general. Most people, when they think of backup, they're looking at it as just this insurance policy, and they don't necessarily see how it ties into a ransomware attack. And really for years, that's really how backup has been bought and sold, right? I need a second copy of my data just in case some terrible storm comes through my area and my office is flooded. There's a fire, there's a tornado, a hurricane, depending on where everybody's located. But the idea here is I just need that second copy of my data just in case the world around me is coming down. I know at least I have a safe copy of data. The problem with kind of looking at it that way is that, you know, we protect a lot of data and we do a lot of studies to try to figure out what the cause of data loss is first, and then more importantly, what the cause of downtime is, because this downtime can be extremely costly. And what we found is 97% of all data loss and downtime have nothing to do with the fires and the floods and the tornadoes and all of these natural disasters that we think we're protecting our data from. The leading cause of downtime, and for most folks that have spent any time in the IT world will tell you, it's user error, right? It's Jim down the hallway inadvertently clicking on the wrong email and infecting the network, or deleting a file or a folder and not knowing where he was supposed to save things. And it's normally human error that's causing a lot of this data loss. And so, you know, what we found is, you know, you really want to protect yourself from your employees. And it's not normally a malicious employee who's trying to do these things intentionally. Normally, as I mentioned, it's just inadvertently not knowing what website they shouldn't be going to, not knowing what attachments they shouldn't be downloading, and inadvertently affecting their network. And you don't really have to look too far in the past to see some really worldwide news stories that showed how, especially these criminals, are exploiting that human error. And I've been going around the world really doing these ransomware presentations for a couple of years now. And when I started out 2.5-3 years ago, I'd go to a room and you get a couple head nods. The more and more I did them, the longer time went on, more and more folks either had been hit with ransomware, knew somebody who had been hit with ransomware. So I saw more and more head nods. But really, this past year, when we saw the WannaCry attack, now we had a story that really swept every news organization, right? It was on the front page of every paper. It was the lead story on every website. We'd never really seen any attack like this before. This was a single strain of ransomware that infected 220,000 computers worldwide in 150 countries. And essentially, they were exploiting human error in order to get in there. And what was interesting was, you know, when we start to look at who's behind in this, because one of the biggest misconceptions about ransomware is that it's just some guy in his basement trying to make a few extra bucks, and he's going to stay down there and do some of these ransomware attacks, make a few $1,000s here or there, and that's how he's going to make a living. The problem is that's not who's behind this. This is what organized crime is doing nowadays, and that could be confirmed by both the Homeland Security and the FBI. And I was actually doing a presentation alongside a gentleman from the FBI out in Pennsylvania about 2 weeks after this WannaCry attack hit. And he was going through all kinds of really scary scenarios, cyber warfare and all that type of stuff. But he closed with ransomware because that was obviously the hot button topic of the day. And he said at the time that the FBI had two main theories. Now, you got to remember, what was interesting about this attack was that they were only charging $300 per ransomware attack across the board. They weren't trying to disseminate whether the company was a large company, a small company, what type of vertical they were in, where they were located. It was just straight across the board, only $300. And so essentially, they didn't make a ton of money off of this attack. And so the FBI's first theory was kind of what most of the IT community believed, which was this was just a test, right? They wanted to see how many computers they can attack in a single day. And then phase two was going to be, okay, now we're going to figure out how to really monetize this. And that's what they thought. And that's what we all thought. But he had a second theory, which at the time seemed a little far-fetched. But anybody that's followed the news lately can attest that maybe this was exactly what was behind the attack. And the second theory was the criminals really didn't care who paid the ransom. Anything they made in those ransomware payments was complete gravy. The second theory states that the entire attack was in order to scare the world into buying Bitcoin, which would then drive up the cost of Bitcoin. And so at the time, it didn't seem like it made a ton of sense, but I did know that the criminals that have been perpetrating these ransomware attacks always ask for the money in Bitcoin because of its anonymity. They know that if they get their money in Bitcoin, the authorities aren't going to be able to catch them. So for years, they've been accumulating Bitcoin, and it's become a very large industry. So now these criminal organizations have tens of millions of dollars tied up into Bitcoin. And then take a look at what the cost of Bitcoin has done. Obviously, it's been in the news pretty much every day over the last several months, but Bitcoin's been around a while, and most of the people that got in on it early on were either, you know, techies who thought this was a cool maybe future of currency, but really who really took the hold of this currency has been the criminals over the last several years. Again, they're specifically asking for this money in Bitcoin. And if you look at the cost of Bitcoin, there was a couple of blips here and there, but pretty much it had stayed pretty stagnant. In January 1st of 2016, a single Bitcoin was $443. The beginning of last year, January 1st of 2017, it was $998. When you see that uptick begin, that was in May. That was when WannaCry hit. And January 1st of this year, a single Bitcoin was over $15,000. And you know, the news will cover this and say, okay, these savvy investors that got in on it early, they became millionaires overnight. And yes, you could find some folks like that. But the people that really became multimillionaires, if not billionaires, from this big boom in Bitcoin were the criminals. Remember, they had been collecting money via these ransomware attacks for the last several years when a Bitcoin was only a couple hundred dollars. So by them scaring the world into now saying, okay, this is a legitimate currency, I need to go out and buy this in case I am attacked, I have to be prepared. They were able to drive the cost of the currency that they held way up. And we've seen it come back down, but for the criminals, it doesn't matter. They were able to cash that out, and they've made a ton of money off of this. So whether they were behind this or not, the theory, obviously, it's almost impossible to prove. But now that you see what Bitcoin has done, it does actually make a ton of sense. Again, it goes to the point that these guys are very sophisticated. It's not the guy in his basement. This is a criminal organization. The organizations are based here in the States, China, Russia, Eastern Europe. They're all over the world. But this is what organized crime has shifted themselves to, because there's so much money to be made, and it's so difficult for the authorities to catch these folks. And so to look at how backup really ties into that, you really got to understand the difference between traditional backup, which has been around for a long time, which is the backup we mentioned at the top of the presentation, which is, okay, I need a second copy of my data just for some sort of disaster, and then move into what the kind of the future of traditional backups become, which is business continuity. Not just making sure that your data is protected with a strong backup, but also giving you the ability to eliminate the downtime, to keep you up and running, keep your business up and running, because those are the two pieces of leverage that these criminals really have. And so when you look at traditional backup, most folks do have some sort of backup. Most companies do, right? Almost everyone is backing up their data in some regard, whether it's, you know, external hard drives or even tape, which is still very prevalent despite its failure rates. Cloud backup has become more and more a larger piece of what's out there in the backup world. But again, all of these traditional form of backups are just a second copy of your data. They're not a true business continuity solution. And so some of the limitations of this backup include higher failure rates. I mean, there's some pretty convincing studies about the failure rates of tape for anyone that's still using tape backups. And those failure rates are pretty high. And the restoration process could be very costly and timely to get those back up. Manual testing. That includes the actual manual process of taking backups. If you're using external hard drives and relying on somebody to actually do that manually, the more we add humans into this, the more human error occurs, and the more that risk of backing up bad data or the backups failing are that much higher. But in addition to that, who is testing those backups? Have you ever tested your backups? Because you're not testing your backups, you're really just rolling the dice if you're ever to be hit by ransomware or just simply have a server failure. The recovery time is very critical in what these criminals are trying to do. Have you ever tried to restore all of your data? Have you ever tried a test? You have several terabytes of data sitting somewhere. Maybe it is in the cloud solution. Have you ever tried to restore that? Have you ever tried to bring several terabytes of data down through the internet? That could be days, if not weeks, to get that accomplished. And so the criminals know that that even if you've got a good backup and you don't want to, and so you could say, okay, I don't have to pay this ransom payment, but they will know that their other piece of leverage is, yeah, but it's going to take you a week to get that data back. Why don't you just pay me my ransom, get your data unencrypted, and be on your way? So the slow recovery time of traditional backup is really one of the things that these criminals are truly exploiting. And then obviously the risk of infection or theft is greater. If you just have an on-premise backup and that's your only backup, there's legitimate threat that somebody can come in and just take your backup solution and now you have nothing. So that risk of infection or theft becomes that much greater with traditional backup. But when you look at business continuity, backup is just a piece of that. True business continuity solution like data, we're going to back up your data, but we're also going to do several other things that truly make it a business continuity solution. So there's really two main components to a business continuity solution. The first is you do want to have a hybrid solution. You don't want your only backup to be in one place. And so I mentioned our two data centers in Salt Lake City, Utah, and Reading, Pennsylvania. With the data solution, you have an on-premise device that's going to be backing up your server or multiple servers, depending on what your environment looks like. All that stuff will be stored on-prem. But it'll also be automatically replicated to both of those data centers. Now you've got three copies of your data in different geographical locations. So if you do have a ransomware attack or you do have maybe a server failure, you could obviously restore your data right from that on-premise device. What if you do have one of those 3% disasters and, you know, your entire office is wiped out and that on-premise backup is compromised as well? Well, now you've got a second copy of your data on Reading, Pennsylvania. Now, what if there's some true storm that's covering an entire eastern seaboard and you're located on the eastern seaboard and whatever's impacting you happens to be impacting Reading, Pennsylvania, a true catastrophic disaster? Well, now you've got a third copy of your data on the other side of the country. That's why we chose those two locations. We wanted them very far apart from one another so that there's no risk of a single catastrophic event impacting all of your backups. So that's really the beauty of a hybrid solution, right? No matter what's going on around you, you're going to have a safe copy of your data that's going to be accessible. The second and most important piece of this is we are an image-based backup solution. Any true business continuity solution is going to be an image-based solution. And what that means is we're not backing things up at the file level. We're not just backing up files and folders. We're actually taking a full snapshot of everything that lives on that server, which will include the operating systems, the applications, everything. So once we take that snapshot of that base image of that server, well, then you could set up a backup schedule for as often as you'd like. And we're just taking block level incremental changes. And one of the things that's unique to Datto is we've got what's called inverse chain technology. Whereas most backups are layered upon previous backups, all of our backup points are independent of one another. So if you're backing up hourly, you'll be able to go in and look at every hour's backups, and they're all independent. So if you're hit with ransomware, there's no risk of it infecting previous backups because they're all independent. And it's as simple as really rolling back to that last clean backup. So this is going to give you the ability to do a couple of things. Now, there's a lot of acronyms and technology, but the two that the criminals know and are try to exploit are your RTO and your RPO. So let's start with the RPO. Your RPO is your recovery point objective, which means how much data are you at risk of losing at any time? Simply put, how often are you taking your backups? Are you taking them weekly? Well, now you're saying, you know, I'm at risk of losing a week's worth of data. And depending on the size of your company, the type of business you're in, that might be aggressive enough for you. Others won't be able to lose an hour's worth of data. So you'd want a much more aggressive RPO. The only caveat to that is you do have to test your backups to have any idea what your RPO truly is. Because you might say, okay, we're taking hourly backups, and that's great, but we've never tested them. And then you get hit with ransomware, and you say, okay, I'm going to restore for my last backup. You find out that our backups have been failing for 3 weeks. Well, now your RPO has just jumped from 1 week, 1 day, 1 hour to 3 weeks. Your RTO is your recovery time objective. This is the second piece of leverage that these criminals have, and that's what I mentioned earlier on. We were talking about how quickly you can restore. Your recovery time objective is how much downtime would you incur, and is that aggressive enough? And what would the cost of that be? Would you be, if your systems were to go down, how long would it take you to restore? Would that be 2 days, 2 weeks, 2 hours? Can you even answer that question? And then the trickier part is to try to put a dollar value on that and figure out, okay, if I'm down for 2 days, how much money is that costing me? Because these criminals are going to send out a ransomware request that they're going to try to say, okay, this ransom payment's going to be less than it would cost you to try to restore. And that's why they're getting so many people to pay. So the goal of a business continuity solution, in addition to backing up your data in multiple places, is to eliminate downtime. And the way we do that is through virtualization. And so quickly, this is what that would look like. If this represents your server and it is infected with ransomware and you get the scary red screen asking for some money, since everything that lived on that server lives on this on-premise device, well, we're able to spin up a virtual machine in a matter of minutes. And now, instead of operating off of that server, this on-premise data device is going to be operating as your server. And everyone that had access to that server is going to have access to this on-premise device. And it's truly going to be business as usual. You're going to be able to make changes in this virtualized state. And we're going to be backing up those changes. So if it takes you a day or a week to replace that server that was infected or wipe it clean, you're going to be up and running during that time. And whenever you're ready to get back and get that data onto that new piece of hardware, well, we could do a bare metal restore and get all of that data, including the changes that you made while you were in that virtualized state, into that new piece of hardware. And so the benefits are pretty clear, right? It's going to reduce that downtime. Instead of talking about days or weeks to recover, we're truly talking about minutes or hours to get all of your systems back up online and give you a true production environment. it's going to help your RTO and your RPO because you're going to be able to answer those questions. You're going to know what your RPO is because you're going to set the backup schedules to an automated schedule for as aggressive a time as you need. And then we're going to be able to answer that RTO question because we could, in a test environment, figure out exactly how quickly we can get those servers up and running. And so we could tell you, okay, if your servers were to go down, we can get you up in 30 minutes or an hour, whatever, you know, depending on the complication and the size of your system. But you also have the ability to do this either locally from this device or from either one of those data centers. So even if that on-premise device is compromised for whatever reason, you could do all of these virtualization capabilities from either data center and keep your business up and running. And that really takes away the leverage that these criminals have. And when you get to that RPO question, I mentioned if you're not testing your backups, there's no way you can answer that. So we've got an automated testing process called screenshot verification. And what this does is it's not just testing that the backups occurred and the data is there. We're actually spinning up that virtualization feature in the background. All of those cool features we saw on that last slide, we're going to test that as well. And we're going to bring that virtualized server up to this boot screen. We're going to take a snapshot of it. I'm going to email it off to Terralogic and their team, and they're going to say, okay, not only is this backup valid, all those virtualization capabilities are there. And so you could truly answer that question. And the reason why this is so important is because downtime can get extremely expensive. Now, the FBI estimated that ransomware alone cost the business community between July 1st of 2016 and July 1st of 2017 about $1 billion. About $1 billion worldwide was paid to these criminals. But the actual cost to that business community is closer to $75 billion. And so what makes up the $75 billion? Well, that's because this number includes the cost of downtime, includes the cost of data loss. There's a lot of folks that will get hit with ransomware, maybe even pay the ransom and never get their data back. Remember, you're dealing with criminals. They just want your money. They really don't care whether they give it back to you or not. And so the ancillary costs to these ransomware attacks are far greater than the actual payment. The downtime is really the piece of leverage that these folks have. And remember what ransomware truly is. It's they're not stealing your data. It used to be that the only folks that were getting attacked were folks that had important data and data that held value on its own, whether it was financial data that these criminals can just extract money right from your company, personal data that could be bought and sold on the black market for identity theft. Those were the companies that were being attacked. What ransomware is doing is just encrypting those files. They're going to encrypt those files and they're going to say, okay, I'll give you that encryption key as long as you pay me some money. And what this gives them the ability to do is not discriminate at all. They don't care what size business you are, what type of business you're in. They're going to rely on the fact that regardless of what type of business you're in or what size your business is, you're going to be relying upon your data. And you will pay to get it back because you can't operate without it. And again, they're going to ask for that in Bitcoin because they know it's almost impossible to catch them. And so how are these guys getting in? And well, that same FBI agent that I did the presentation without in Pennsylvania, he's given all these scary stats and figures. And all of a sudden, in the middle of his presentation, he throws up a picture of a house. It looks like a regular house. And he says, anybody recognize this house? Now, I'm in a room of about 150 people, and everybody's kind of looking around. A couple seconds later, a gentleman in the back of the room leans forward and says, hey, that looks a lot like my house. And he goes, it is your house. That's right. Congrats. It's a beautiful house. And you just got a promotion at work too, right? Congratulations on that. Graduated from Penn State in 2002. That's a great school. And he starts rattling off all these facts about this guy. And he goes, I bet you think I used all the technology at my disposal at the FBI to gather this information about this gentleman, right? Wrong. All I did was I talked to the organizer of this event last week. I got a list of registrants and I picked one of you guys at random. And the first thing I did was I said, okay, I'll find you on LinkedIn. And I got a bunch of information in about 5 minutes from your LinkedIn profile. And then I saw if I could find you on Facebook now that I knew what your face was and got a bunch of information off of that as well. That's where I got this beautiful picture of your house. And then I tried to find you on Twitter and Instagram and all these other social media sites. And in about 15 minutes, I gathered a lot of information that I could use. Because it was, you know, it used to be the criminals would send out these emails saying they're your long-lost uncle and send me $5,000. And I'll send you $1 million. And that was how they were getting in. Luckily, most people aren't falling for that. So what these criminals are doing is they're going to do their homework up front. They're going to use socially engineered spear phishing attacks with the goal of making these emails that go out look like every other email in your inbox. And so what this FBI agent said he would do. He'd say, okay, I'd go right for the low-hanging fruit. I know you graduated from Penn State. I know they've got one of the largest alumni associations in the world. And so what I'll do is I'll send you out an email. It's going to look like every other email you've gotten from the alumni association. Same template, everything. And within there, there's going to be a hyperlink, and it's going to say, click here to download all the information you need for our 15-year reunion. And you're going to click on it because it looks like every email you've gotten. And if that doesn't work, I'll go through your LinkedIn profile, and I'll find some of your coworkers or maybe somebody in your finance department or your boss, and I'm going to set up a dummy email account that's going to look just like that, except maybe one letter's off. And I'm going to send you out an email with that as well, with an attachment that's going to infect your network. And I'm going to go through the list, and eventually it's going to be a Friday afternoon. You're trying to clean up your inbox so you can go home and have a clean slate for the weekend, and you're trying to click through 50 emails quickly, and I'm going to catch you sleeping, and I'm going to infect your network. And so the 15 minutes it took me to do a little homework about you and your company, they're going to give me that much more of a success when I'm trying to infect your network. Again, that's what we're up against. It's the sophistication of these guys that's critical. And again, it's $75 billion, most of that coming from the downtime, that was really the impact of the business community. And whereas most IT professionals are very concerned about it, close to 90%, when you talk to small business owners, the vast majority are not highly concerned about it because it's the same theory. If it hasn't happened to me, I'm not concerned about it. But obviously the numbers are staggering, the amount of people that are being hit with this ransomware. And to show you the amount of companies that are being affected, because usually in the news, we just see the hospitals and universities and these large companies that are being asked for large sums of money, when in fact, the average payment to these criminals is only about $2,000. Now, of the $1 billion that changed hands, it's estimated that over $700 million of that came from the SMB community. So you break down $700 million into $2,000 increments, and you could see how many businesses are being attacked and how many of them have no other recourse but to pay the ransom. It's a staggering number worldwide. They estimated that last year, one in 20 companies worldwide were hit with ransomware. That's a staggering number when you look at all the companies out there. And so, you know, it truly is running rampant. Those numbers came from one of the studies that we did, but even the government put out an alert last year talking about ransomware specifically. And they said, okay, here's some of the more prevalent variants that are out there. Here's some of the techniques these guys are getting using to get in. Here's the reasons why you shouldn't pay. And then they came up with a list of recommendations. And you'd think their recommendations would be on the preventative side. But in fact, their number one recommendation was employ a data backup and recovery plan for all of your critical information, because they will know that they have very little chance of catching these guys. And so you've got two options. You could pay the ransom, which obviously you don't want to do. It's going to embolden these guys. It's going to increase the risk of you getting attacked again. You might not get your data back. And your second option is to restore from a backup. And that's why the type of backup you have is critical. And that's why business continuity is really the only way to protect yourself. And so most folks, as I mentioned, probably have a backup solution. So I'll leave you with two examples of trying to figure out what that cost of downtime looks like. The first example I'm going to give you is the San Francisco Metro Transit Authority. They get hit with ransomware on Black Friday a couple of years back, and they were asked for $73,000 in ransom. These criminals are smart. They know when to hit, when it's going to hurt the most. And so to their credit, they put out an alert right away, and they said, yes, we've been hit with ransomware. We were asked for $73,000, and no, we have no intentions of paying these guys. As I mentioned, the government recommends that we don't pay these folks, but also we have a very robust backup system. We're very convinced that we're going to get all of our systems back up online. Now, one of the systems that was hit was a system that processes fares for the bus system and the light rail. And so when they got their IT team together, they said, okay, well, how long are we going to be down? And they said, well, we're pretty confident that we'll have all of our systems back up online by Sunday morning. So they're looking at 2 days without access to these systems. So they had two options. The first option, which really wasn't an option, was to just shut down the light rail and the bus system on the two busiest shopping days of the year. Obviously, they couldn't go that route. So their second option, which is the one that they did, was they gave away free fares. They gave away free rides for 2 days on their light rail and their bus system. And while they never talked about how much money they lost being down 2 days, they do offer a lot of information on their website, so I'm able to do the math for them. Now, according to their website, they provide 735,000 rides every single day. That number probably would be higher on Black Friday and the following Saturday, but let's just take their numbers. Now, that number doesn't break down how many of those folks are riding the bus and the light rail, but I do know that it costs $1 to ride the bus and $2.25 to ride the light rail. So if you look at 735,000 rides a day over 2 days, you look at the cost of what they would normally get in fares, they lost anywhere between $1.5 and $3.3 million in lost revenue. They could have paid the $73,000. Instead, they lost several million dollars in lost revenue. And whereas the San Francisco Metro Transit Authority might be able to absorb this, most businesses cannot. And most businesses are faced with that type of math where I could pay a couple thousand dollars in ransom or I could be down several days, which is going to cost me a lot more. And that's why so many people are paying it. But this example is me having to do some math and some forensics. I'll give you another example that I actually heard while I was sitting on a panel with a gentleman who sells cybersecurity insurance. And he tells a story with the goal of saying this is why you need cybersecurity insurance. But afterwards, I picked his brain about the story. I went and researched it. It's pretty amazing. There was a utility company out in Lansing, Michigan that got hit with ransomware. This was a company that had a very robust IT team. There's over 50 employees on that staff. They were asked for $25,000. For a day, they tried to figure out if they could restore their data and not have to pay that ransom. But it became pretty evident towards the end of the day that they had no other recourse but to pay that ransom. It's the only action they could do to unlock that system. The issue was they paid the ransom and all of their systems had been locked up. It took them about a full week to get completely up and running. Now, these folks had cybersecurity insurance, so they went to work to try to figure out what their claim would be. How much money did this cost them to be down for a week? And the number that they came up with, it was $2.4 million. Now, $400,000 of this number was for increased security, an updated backup system, ways to try to prevent it. So they weren't able to submit that to their insurance company. But just the cost of downtime alone came to $2 million. And so they submitted a claim for $2 million. They had a $100,000 deductible, so they were asking for $1.9 million. The insurance company reviewed their documentation, and they paid out $1.9 million to this utility company. Now, my experience with insurance companies, they don't tend to pay out on claims that aren't real. So this has now been vetted by an insurance company to justify the cost of that downtime. This is where we get to that $75 billion number. Not only did these folks pay the $25,000 in ransom, they then had to go make close to a half a million dollar investment into upgrading all of their systems. They also had to pay the $100,000 deductible. And yes, they were able to recoup their cost, but we're looking at a true math of what the cost of downtime is. And the ripple effects went beyond just the cost. When I kept researching this, I found that within the next 6 months, 6 months after that attack, a full one quarter, 25% of their IT staff had left the company. They'd quit because the environment had become too toxic and it was just too much for them, and they went and found other jobs. And so now this company was also faced with looking at replacing 25% of their IT staff. And anyone that out there looking for IT staff knows it's not always the easiest thing to do and find some competent people in that space. And so that is what we're looking at here. So with that, if you do have any questions, there's a chat box. You could type that in. Hopefully you do get something out of this webinar. We did record it, so everybody will be getting a recording. If you want to share that with some of the folks in your office, feel free to do that. With that, do you have anything else to add?
We are good, Michael. Thank you so much for your time.
Perfect. Well, you've got the information you need there on the screen. If you want to reach out, I highly encourage you reach out to Terralogic. Let them kind of take a look at what you have in place now. If there are any gaps there, make sure that you could truly answer that RPO and that RTO question, and make sure you're protected, because when it comes to these criminals, it's only growing. And so I hope everyone has a great weekend. As I mentioned, this recording will go out, and thank you all for joining us today.